Good morning to all of you. It's a great honor to be invited to inaugurate this EduVision conference. When I was listening to Mr. Kaitan, and he said it was the industrial age, then the information age, and then the creative age, I started wondering what I have been doing for the last 50 years. I have been in the area of creativity, and I basically believe that all ages are ages of creativity. There has hardly been any age which is not an age of creativity. I feel very comfortable here today for many reasons. One of the reasons is I am a son of a teacher, and I am feeling very much at home with all of you teachers. The other reason is Aparna Paliyekar, your president, is a close friend. She's actually even sharing my birthday. We share a birthday together. And we have often celebrated birthdays together. I myself, I'm a perpetual student and an occasional teacher. And I also feel very much at home with all of you today, because I do not believe in caste. But I feel that all of us belong to the same caste, and our caste is basically the caste of education, of teachers. And we pray to the same deity, the deity of knowledge. Prayers to the deity of knowledge is what we follow. I feel that the profession of teachers is one of the most important professions. It's the noblest professions, because I believe that education is the foundation of the development of any country, any culture. When the British left India, our literacy rate was just 12%. And in today, it is 74%, almost six times more. And I think all of this has happened basically because of teachers. Unfortunately, the brightest of our students don't aspire to be teachers. They aspire to be engineers or doctors or management professionals. But let me remind you that the most intricate machine in the whole world is the mind of a child. And to handle that mind of a child, you require utmost skills, more skills than an engineer who is handling a machine of a jet engine or any other machine. So I think the teacher's profession, teacher's job, is one of the most important jobs for creation of a good society. I was recently invited at a career guidance course which was organized by one of the big business houses here. I went to this career guidance course. I had a daughter who had just finished her 12th standard, and most of the students there had finished their 12th standard, and they were listening to people who had come to guide them in their career. I was invited to guide them in the career as an artist. And I listened to this career guidance, and most of the speakers, unfortunately, basically talked about, if you take this profession, how much you will earn. If you take this profession, how much you will earn. Somebody said, if you become a dentist, you'll earn this much. But if you become a dental technologist, then you can earn a little bit more, actually, because I know one dental technologist who has a BMW. And he only wears yeah. So, I mean, the whole idea of the whole, the discussion there was essentially about what profession you can take to earn how much. And I think here lies the basic fault, but I believe that the purpose of education is not to make a living. Making a living is a byproduct of education. Purpose of education is far from just to learn to make a living. It is actually to learn how to live. It is not about making a living, but it is about how to live purposefully, how to live fruitfully, how to respond to nature, how to respond to, so many other interesting things in life, and how to be more human. That is actually the purpose of education, and it is not about making a living. When I was a child, I always love to laugh and to smile at not anything particular, and I have not given up that habit yet. So I used to just laugh, and my teachers would ask me, "Why are you laughing?" Then when I started drawing sketches when I was in the college, the teachers would ask me, "Why are you drawing?" When I was in medical college, I'm a doctor originally, now I have given up medicine to become an artist. So when I started, I became the cartoonist for the Navin Times, which is a newspaper here, when I just finished my 12th standard. And during a boring lecture, I would start thinking about a cartoon for the next day. And the teachers asked me, "Why are you thinking?" So basically it starts from, why are you laughing, why are you smiling, why are you drawing, and why are you thinking? So I think there is a very interesting word called hidden talents. We say somebody has hidden talents. So now why do we say somebody has hidden talents? The reason why we say somebody has hidden talents is because society is in a habit of hiding talents of most people. The whole education system is hiding talents. Instead of telling somebody, "Okay, please smile, laugh, draw, think, sing," you say, "Don't do this, don't do that." That's why perhaps this terminology has come of hidden talents. So, well, I became a medical doctor. I started a hospital. But then somewhere I started feeling that, well, this is not my thing. I was a very successful doctor, doing very, very well. But I felt that this is not something I should be doing all my life. And there was another reason too. Most of my patients in Calangute, where I had a hospital, were British tourists. And these British tourists were suffering from one disease, was dysentery, loose motions. So the idea that I will spend my lifetime treating British loose motions was very scary. So I decided that India has taken enough shit from the British for 150 years and I did not want to take any more. So I gave up my medicine and I decided to pursue my passion, which is visual art. And I must tell you, I'm absolutely convinced that the only purpose of life is to be happy. There is no other purpose in life. The only purpose is to be happy. And if you do something which you love to do, there is a possibility that you will be happy. If you do something which you do not like to do, you will be definitely unhappy. So I think the very purpose of education is to help people become happy, to bring out whatever talents they have, the children have, and basically make their life more fruitful. I think there was a remark made by Ms. Kaitan about playfulness. Now, last week I was in Korea doing an installation. And the curatorial note of this exhibition where I was participating was written by a gentleman called Johan Huizinga. Now this Johan Huizinga was a Dutchman who wrote a thesis in 1897. In 1897, he got his doctoral thesis, a doctoral degree in a University of Netherlands in Amsterdam, and his thesis was about jokers in Sanskrit plays. He was a scholar of Sanskrit. And in 1897, he gets his PhD degree for his thesis about jokers, jesters in Sanskrit plays of India. Now, he argued that the most important aspect of human nature is fun, playfulness. He says playfulness is most essential for a formation of a culture. It's actually not just most essential, it's the primary element of human culture, of human development. And so, have you ever, had a need to force a child to play? Please go and play. We never have to tell a child to play, because playfulness is inborn in human nature. And it's why does a child play? Because through play, it learns. Learning happens through play. When a child is playing football or cricket or with any toys, it's a process of learning, and it is already ingrained in the human genes, because playfulness is actually primary to development of human culture. So I think it's a very, very profound thesis done in 1897 already by a Dutchman who was a scholar of Sanskrit and who studied playfulness in Sanskrit plays in India. It's a very, very interesting thing. And that was the primary thesis about my art exhibition in Korea, because it was about art and sea and fun. I have actually followed the same idea of playfulness in my museum. Mind you, I have a museum called Museum of Goa, which narrates history. And it narrates history through a contemporary idiom, but with total playfulness and fun. It becomes fun to understand history, so I will request all of you, those who have not already been to my museum, to come to the Museum of Goa and basically understand Goa's history, not just for you, but we are actually looking forward to have all students from different schools in Goa to come and connect with the museum, because I feel art education is equally important. I will just make a very simple experiment. I must check how much time I have. Five minutes. I will just narrate 10 names to you. 8-10 names. Subodh Gupta, Sudarshan Shetty, Riyaz Komu, Krishnamachari Bose, Atul Dodia, Vivan Sundaram, Anita Dubey, Vasudev Gaitonde, Francis Newton Souza. How many people have heard these names? Please raise your hands. Okay, how about 4-5 names, 10 people have raised. And all of you are teachers, you are very well educated, and most people have not heard this name. I mean, I'm not blaming you for that, not at all. But you have not heard these names for the simple reason that you have never been exposed to them. Now, I will tell you, these names are some of the topmost artists of India, the present contemporary artist of India. And if you have to convert them into a little economic thing, I mean, what kind of money they earn through their work, let me tell you that Vasudev Gaitonde, who actually was from Goa, sold his work about this size for 28 crores last year. 28 crores. And most people have not heard of Vasudev Gaitonde. Somebody who have heard of the artist's name have not been connected with the work. You do not know what he did. Why did he earn 28 crores? So, now the thing is, not knowing the names of these artists is very similar to not have heard of, for example, Amitabh Bachchan. Or who is Lata Mangeshkar? I don't know. It is very similar. But then again, I cannot blame you, because you have never been given an opportunity to go to a gallery of contemporary art and have a look at the contemporary works of art. And you miss a lot, because it is very, very important to connect with arts for everybody. Whether you're a doctor, engineer, educator, anybody, it is important to connect with art, because when you connect with art, many things happen. In a country of 135 crores, not more than 1 lakh people connect with contemporary art, which is a sad state of this country. Apart from Delhi, where there's a National Gallery of Modern Art, where you can see a sampling of the contemporary artist work, there is no place in the whole country where you can see that. Well, mine is a very small effort, Museum of Goa. Though my museum, Museum of Goa, is the largest contemporary art space in the country, one of the largest contemporary art spaces. So please come, have a look at it. And why is it important to connect with contemporary art? Because I tell you that when you connect with any arts, you become a better human being. Because it is your right to connect with arts, because it is arts which make civilizations. Art, education, these are the things which make civilizations. It's not just business. Art is very important. And if you see the history of human civilization, it is essentially the history of arts of all kinds. Whether it is theater, literature, music, history of human civilization is history of arts, and it is very important to connect, because if you do not connect, then you become a lesser human being. For example, art makes you plural. Art, I mean, reminds you there is more than one interpretation possible of a work of art. Art makes you more tolerant. So to create a tolerant plural society, it is very important to connect with arts. I can just connect with one very interesting poem by Rumi. What does art do? There's a poem by Rumi, says there is a field of the right and there is a field of the wrong, and beyond that field, there is another field. Let us meet there. So art does not believe this is right and this is wrong in black and white, but there's also something else available. So art just holds your finger and takes you to that field, which is beyond the field of right and wrong. So it is very important to connect with art, and I will definitely appeal, and also I would like to collaborate and cooperate with the schools to introduce as much as possible art, because right now we are working on a 2-credit course which can be taken by anybody, which will be recognized by the university. So we have made an application, so this can be taken by anybody. It is an introduction to contemporary art. Well, I think I have spoken for long. I will only make a small reference to the latest project which I have been working on is on Gandhi. I have decided to spend next 3 years working on Gandhi. It's going to be the largest art exhibition connected with Gandhi. It will be an ongoing process for next 3 years because this is the 100th year of Gandhi's Champaran movement. Gandhi came to India in 1915. And 1917, he had the first satyagraha on Indian soil, which was in Champaran in Bihar. And this is the 100th anniversary of Champaran. And 2019 will be 150th anniversary of Gandhi's his birth anniversary. So essentially, Gandhi was also a great educationist. Gandhi was many things in one. He was a saint, he was a politician, he was an educationist. He started a whole new system of education, which is called Nayi Talim. And some of the schools are still going on. Gandhi was a policeman. He could basically stop the riots single-handedly when the whole police machinery and the whole military machinery failed. So I'm creating this exhibitions all over the country, and we are doing the largest museum of Gandhi in Jharkhand, in a place called Nimdi. Why I'm making a reference to Gandhi is because I started thinking, if Gandhi was alive today, what issue would he take? And I came to the conclusion that Gandhi would start an anti-littering campaign. That's because littering is an act of violence. Littering is an act of violence against Mother Earth. It's also an act of violence against yourself. Because Gandhi was very creative when he chose his issues, whether it is salt satyagraha, whether it is Swadeshi. So he would take an anti-litter campaign. I think it is very, very important that one of the most important things taught at all schools, at all levels, is not to litter. Because when you litter, I would consider it's an act of violence, it's also an act of sedition perhaps. If you do not litter, you become a better citizen. You are more aware of your duties as a citizen. So a simple act of not littering can make you a better person, a better citizen. I think I have taken enough of your time. Thank you very much for giving me a very patient hearing. I would only request you that, well, try to make your students better human beings. Teaching involves also loving. Because as a teacher, you have to like your students and the students have to like you. If you do not like your students, no student learns anything from anybody he does not like. So first of all, you have to make yourself very lovable, loving to your students. Only then, I think they will learn from you. It's also very important that there is not much competition to be encouraged. Because I believe that competition should be amongst horses, not amongst human beings. So let us hope that we create a better society through education. And congratulations to all of you, because I basically believe that teachers are the real architects of modern India. Thank you.